This morning I got an email from one of my former students, Hong Sa, who wrote that he wished he could have been here, and he wished he could have known my story when he was a grad student, because he always thought that I had had a smooth career without any struggles. And then I knew again why we were doing this. Because of course his implication was that he would have felt better about his own struggles if he had known. So my story actually begins in China in 1926, because my grandfather immigrated from China to Holland. He was very young at the time, 18 or 19, and he built his own business in Holland. So my mom was born in Holland. My grandfather was one of the second wave of Chinese in Holland. So the first wave had been Chinese migrants who had worked on steamships, and some of whom settled in Holland in 1900 and 1910. But my mom was born in Amsterdam, but her parents, so my grandparents, were still quite traditionally Chinese. And the reason I'm telling you that is because I think everybody's story starts with their family background. In my case, it was a very strange mix of backgrounds, because on one hand, my mom was very much a traditional tiger mom, so grades are important, social life is not. And on the other hand, she grew up in Holland, so in the 1960s, which was a pretty like activist, rebellious time, and she was also pretty much an activist, rebellious person. So that doesn't fit in Chinese culture at all. Actually, when she was around 18 or 19, she went back to China and started teaching in the, while she was still a student herself, she also taught Dutch and English in the Beijing Broadcasting Institute in Beijing, which is now called, I think, Communications University of China. And there, in China, there was this international store where it was meant for foreigners, and there were very few foreigners at the time in China. So it was a very exclusive place. But then the Chinese themselves were not allowed to go into that store. So my mom would stage a protest with this wall and newspapers in order to protest this injustice. So I feel that some of my later activism sort of has a roots in like what I got from my upbringing. The tiger mom side probably had as one of the consequences that I learned things at home that other kids would learn in school, just reading and basic math. So when I went to primary school and then I was not allowed to read and do math and I had to play, then I was very annoyed and I started bullying other kids and really, really annoyed at me. They let me skip grades, so I ended up skipping 4 grades in primary school. If you think back to your primary school experience, you probably also would have been able to do it. Probably the reason that you didn't do it is because you it would not have been really desirable for your social emotional development, and it wasn't for mine. So in short, going to high school at age 8 and to college at age 14 makes for a pretty fucked up childhood. One example is like my mom still had to bite me to school when I was in high school, junior high school. Right? So I was 8, going to high school, and the worst part of that was that the moment that I had a low grade, and low was anything below 100%, my mom would get at me on the way back from school. So I remember my first ever test in French, which is that you had to write down what the teacher said, and the first word was l'histoire, and that means the history, but then the part is connected to a history, so it sounds completely different, and I was completely confused. And I had only a 70 on the test, and my mom would yell at me the whole way, and not just the whole way, the rest of the day, and then for several more days. The next time I had an 85, I thought, well, that must be good enough for her. No, same deal. The next time, 97, same deal. 100 was good enough, so that was the type of mom said. Of course, I also didn't really have a normal relationship with my classmates, because everybody was 4 years younger, so I was sort of the sort of the cute little brother who was hanging out in the class, and you couldn't really talk to him as equals. On top of that, I was also pretty annoying still. So my mom had told me that one way to challenge me intellectually was to point out mistakes in what the teacher was saying, which I beautifully did, to the great annoyance of the teacher as well as my classmates. So I was a bit of an outlier in those days, at least in those days. I liked physics. I wasn't particularly good at it. My final score in physics was 70 out of 100. So I was actually much better in Latin and Greek, and 100 in Latin and Greek. But then, for some reason, that didn't seem like as promising a career as physics. So I went to study physics in my hometown, Groningen, which people from certain language families can probably pronounce. It's a very ugly sound, Groningen. But it's a small town. Most tourists don't go there. It's maybe 2.5 hours away from Amsterdam. It's a very homogeneous town as well. So in my high school, I was one of maybe 5 Chinese kids, and 5 out of 400, and 2 of those 5 were my brothers. So yeah, I just didn't add up. I went to study physics in my hometown. That was fun up to a certain point, because like when it came to quantum theory, I started losing the hang of it. Like that was the point where things just became very murky and unclear and complicated, and I didn't want to admit that to myself yet. So because I was so much younger, everybody thought I was a genius, so I had internalized that kind of belief, so I felt I should be able to deal with it, even though it got really hard. I also picked an undergraduate advisor, and then this undergraduate advisor pretty much offered me a PhD position while I was still undergraduate, so I went on to do a PhD with him pretty immediately afterwards, without looking at alternatives. And my mom was also sort of pressuring me to stay at home because I was 17, and for me to go abroad at that age, and my brothers were still young, that was maybe less desirable. But anyway, I made a really bad decision of staying in Groningen for my PhD. It was bad for two reasons. So one is generally it's better to have a change of environment, change of intellectual environment in particular. But also, my advisor was somebody who was very close to retirement, and not only that, he hadn't really kept up with the field. So he had done some really good work in the 1970s, and pretty much hadn't done very much since. And the way it goes in Holland is that the way you get promoted, that you go from the equivalent of assistant to associate to full professor, is just by growing older. Right? So as you grow older, you rise in seniority. You don't even have to do very much for it. And that had pretty much happened to my advisor at the time. I also chose a topic that he was not an expert in, and that sounds really strange, but that was possible. The way it works is just that the advisor accepts you as sort of an employee. You're not a grad student, there's no coursework, there's no program, you're an employee of that professor. So when he offered me the PhD position, that was it. And my plan was to do something in the field of quantum gravity, which is this attempt to unify forces of nature. And his expertise was in statistical physics, so it was actually not a very good match. Does anybody know this blog post that's called Top 5 Traits of Bad Advisors? Who knows that? Okay, so yeah, in my lab some people know it, but if you don't know it, please look it up after this. So what are the top 5 traits of bad advisors according to this blog? So one is somebody's always absent, it happens quite a bit. Somebody's always negative, nothing you do is good enough. Somebody is close to retirement, like my professor at the time. And then another one, which is pretty common, is advisor is maddeningly inconsistent. So a true story, a student comes to me pretty much in tears and says, 2 months ago I had a discussion with my advisor, I really wanted to plan A, And then after long discussion, my advisor convinced me to do plan B, even though I didn't really think it was that interesting. Then 2 months later, the advisor was on sabbatical, so they didn't talk in 2 months. And then after 2 months, the student presented the results of plan B. Advisor says, oh, that's all right, but yeah, why actually did you do this? There's this other thing that you could have done. I was going to be much more interesting, plan A. And this is like one of the things that is on that list of like bad advisors. Now that I'm on the other side, I know it's not always malicious. Like, we sometimes just forget what you said. We sometimes forget that the ideas are your ideas instead of our ideas. We sometimes are very sloppy in the organization of projects. But of course, that's not an excuse. Right? And if it keeps happening, then you might have to look for another advisor. It happened in this case. I think the student is happy now. In my case, it was just doomed to fail, and it did fail. So my first 2 years of my PhD, I had these grandiose ideas about this, or Barbie's quantum gravity theories, but I had absolutely nothing to show for it. Every time I met with my advisor, advisors thought this, everything was great that I did, but that was mostly because he had no idea what I was doing, and I had no idea what I was doing. So at some point, people around me who had more common sense, they said, you should find another advisor, a second advisor. So I found another advisor, much younger guy, also in the Netherlands, different university, who was much more on top of his field, and he was actually working on quantum gravity, actually string theory. So I started working with him. That was a much better mentorship relationship. However, I also found out that this is just crazy hard. And I couldn't just blame my advisor, right? Sometimes you have to blame your advisor. In many cases, I've had many conversations like this, and my experience is that students blame themselves. If something goes wrong in their project, experiment doesn't work out, simulation doesn't work out, they blame themselves. I'm not good enough, I didn't work hard enough, I'm not smart enough. Sometimes you have to blame your advisor, maybe they didn't give you the right mentorship. And and of course, it can also happen that science is just fucking hard, and that's why things fail, right? So it's about a sort of attribution of failure, right? It's not just you, it's you, your advisor's mentorship staff, the difficulty of the problem, they all have causal links to failure. You have to realize that and not attribute everything to yourself. I blame my advisor to some extent, but then I also had to blame a mismatch between the difficulty of the problem and my abilities. So I don't know how much you know about string theory, but it's really abstract, math. At some point, you don't know if you're doing physics or math, and many of the theories that emerge from that field are really hard to test. It was a problem back then, still a problem now. If you can build an accelerator the size of the universe, you can do it. If you can turn back time to around the time of the Big Bang, you can test those theories. So you get an idea of how hard this is. And that didn't appeal to me. It didn't appeal to me that I was doing what felt like abstract math most of the time. I had this lost this connection with reality. And maybe in part of that, I was also struggling with actually making progress. So if you look at my CV, I have two papers out of my PhD. I was second author on both. The first author was another graduate student of my second advisor. And to tell the truth, he was sort of 70% or so responsible for each of those papers. So he came up with the ideas, and I was sort of walking along, trying to catch up, trying to stay on top of stuff. So my PhD never felt my own. And that really sucked. That was a really bad feeling. And I think and I know that most of you are in a much better situation than that. So that's already something to be proud of. That your PhD, including all struggles, is going to feel like your own. How did I deal with that? Mostly by denial. I still had this inflated self-image. So I thought that nothing should be too hard for me. But there was the reality. So one way to escape from the reality was to do lots of other things outside of my PhD, to the point that my office mate started complaining that I was on the phone about for my organizational work more than I was working on a PhD, which is true. So yeah, I was active in this nature study organization where, you know, excursions captive were in nature, study look at birds and animals and those kind of things. I was active in Dutch politics where I would organize debates. I like to play online chess, which is still alive, and I wasted way too many hours in that. But yeah, I did pretty much everything I could to avoid working on a PhD. And the end result was that I had very little basis to actually defend my PhD on. And the reason that they gave me a PhD was pretty much because I had told my advisor that I would leave the field. And then they say, okay, you can do it. So, this was a really strange situation because I got my PhD at 22, but I internally knew that this was not really my own accomplishment and that I was not really good enough to continue in this field. So it was this mismatch that the Dutch TV wanted to interview me, and then this internal feeling that I actually didn't deserve all that attention. That doesn't mean that I didn't like the attention, so I did go on to mostly my organization, so that's it. Very little about my actual science, because there was not much to talk about there. But yeah, that was sort of a sobering realization that lots of the public perception of science is quite superficial, and of course scientists are in part to blame for that. And like this whole notion of being well known, it's very fleeting and meaningless if you think about it. In some cases, not always. So yeah, what to do then? I had considered going into Dutch politics. People more sensible than me dissuaded me from that. I thought of going into consulting because McKinsey, this consulting company, was using quantitative methods, sounded attractive. Projects were about 3 months long, so you could switch relatively quickly, sounded attractive. So I interviewed McKinsey in Amsterdam. The first part of the interview was like a math test. I did well on that, and there was a conversation with one of the partners. Then they asked you questions like, supermarkets have the fruits and vegetables near the entrance. Come up with reasons why, 10 reasons, right now. And they have to come up with 10 reasons. And they just want to know if you can think on your feet, which I wasn't particularly good at. I came to 3 reasons or so, and then, yeah, I have no clue. The other thing that they asked is, do you read the economics page of the NRC Handelsblad, which is the best newspaper every day? I say, no, not if I can avoid it. I didn't say that part. But he said, yeah, you should really start doing that. I've been doing that since I was 16, and through lots of good stuff in there. I thought maybe consulting is not for me. So the other interest that I had picked up, also sort of as a procrastination thing, was to go to psychology talks. So I had this interest in how the brain works, and I just sat into some of some public lectures, and even a psychonomics symposium. I remember quite vividly there was one talk about the McGurk effect. Who knows the McGurk effect? Most people, it's this auditory visual speech illusion. It was very striking, and I was blown away by this illusion. And then I was blown away that somebody could make a living studying this. As a proper physicist, I was very arrogant, in addition to my sort of innate arrogance. So I thought, like, good physics tradition, like physics is sort of on top of the mountain, and then chemistry is applied physics, biology is applied chemistry, psychology is somewhere way down in the basement. So yeah, as a physicist, I was supposed to look down on physics, but I actually found it really interesting, so it was sort of a conflict. Then I was interested in that. But yeah, there was of course the option of going into computational neuroscience, and that was a bit of a burgeoning field at that time. Like it was relatively new. This was 2001, and then there was some funding for physicists to switch to computational neuroscience. So I ended up doing that, and if you have your own funding, it's much easier to find a postdoc position. So I ended up with Christoph Koch at Caltech. On paper, that sounded like a great match. So he was a physicist, a former physicist, who had switched to computational neuroscience, and was now interested in consciousness. So one thing I should mention is that I was interested in consciousness. So I had still those grandiose feelings that I could solve like some big science scientific problem. So if I couldn't solve the origin of the universe, why wouldn't I solve quantum statistics? Using statistical physics, of course. It's a bit embarrassing, you know, if anything done to it. But yeah, there was starting this postdoc was like I wrote in the blurb my renewed chance in these delusions of grandeur. And so I went to this lab, which sounded like a good message. On paper, Christoph was a very interesting, accomplished scientist, but his mentorship that didn't match with me, with mine, because he was very well known already, and he was giving talks everywhere. I had a big lab, 20 people, so I would be lucky to meet with him maybe once every 2 or 3 weeks for half an hour or so. So he was a very hands-off mentor. That's not what I needed. So I was a big procrastinator, and so I would find any excuse to not work. And I sometimes talk with Christina Alberini, my co-host in the series, about why it is. And she's a psychoanalyst, so she says you have to look at your childhood. And it has deep roots. Procrastination is actually a deep psychological problem. I hear somebody at City College when I did something similar to this say, well, that's complete bullshit. Procrastination is actually the natural state of being. We're not meant to do science, we're meant to have fun and play. I like that. I kept playing online games all the time, and reading the news, and going to the beaches in LA. Because this was sort of also my first opportunity to, first occasion that I lived away from my mom. So I was 22 years old. I moved from this provincial town in Holland to LA. Lots of temptations. I also like took advantage of that. So and I made some really nice road trips to Yosemite and Las Vegas. And, that was what I should be working on, establishing myself as a postdoc in this new field. So, needless to say, that didn't go very well. So, if you look at my CV again, I have one book chapter with Christoph. And after two years, he pretty much kicked me out of his lab. So he said, what have you done these 2 years? And I pretty much had very little to show for it. And he said, okay, I'll give you 2 more months and you're out of here. That was in March 2004. That came as a big shock, because I thought very naively that I could get away with everything, that things would just magically work out that they had until that point. I did have some saving graces in this case, so I had started pretty much also as a procrastination project. I had started collaborating with another postdoc in the lab, Patrick Wilken, who was an experimental psychologist who had done some work on working memory, and he wanted to collaborate with a modeler. I knew some math, so and he was around all the time, so that worked out as a collaboration. We got a nice paper out of that before. I didn't think much of that, but actually that turned out to be a pretty important paper for the field and for my own career. That was one thing that I did get out of that postdoc, and I had another similar collaboration with another postdoc at Caltech. Still, there was not much to show for 2 years of postdoc in a top lab. I was also lucky that at that time, Alex Bouget, who was computational neuroscience in Rochester, came to give a talk, and we ended up having a conversation. And in that conversation, I said, in this project that I'm working with Christoph, I'm supposed to make a link between neuroactivity and probability. I have no clue how this is done. I see these two possibilities of doing this. Can you tell me what you think is better? And I had expected him to say, okay, read these papers of mine. He had been working on this for a while. Come back to me if you have any questions. And instead he said, this is actually a really complicated problem. I have no clue. I don't think the field has a clue. Both of these possibilities you're mentioning, they are quite sensible. And I really like that style. He was really humble. It was very surprising. He was French. sorry, Pierre. You heard me make that joke before, I think. That messaged me, and he gave me the chance to be a postdoc in his lab in Rochester. Anybody been to Rochester? Wait, I can't recommend it. It's in the middle of nowhere, not so steep. Sorry, what do you think, Mary?
It's beautiful, I grew up there.
Yeah.
Nice try.
Let's say it works for some people. The science was really good there. Center for Vision Science, Brain Cognitive Science, and it was a very collaborative environment too. So scientifically, it worked out very, very well for me. In terms of mentorship style, Alex was also much better matched to me. So I tried procrastinating there as well. So after 3 months of me pretty much doing other things, Alex came to her office and said, "What the fuck have you been doing these months?" And I had very little to show for it. And he said, "You better get your act together or you're out of here." And that's what I needed to hear, because then I started working with it. I still procrastinated. So during my second postdoc, I started a nonprofit organization. Pretty much as a procrastination person. Alex was tolerant of that, but he made sure that I actually got shit done. So I got some nice papers out of this time. And this was also the point that I started growing up a little bit, like emotional maturity. Right? For most people, it comes in the early 20s. I had to be 25 or 26 to reach that point. I also then turned it to the other way. So I had been this very arrogant little brat, and then later it turned into full-fledged imposter complex. So the way that came about, especially in Rochester, was because I was working alongside this other postdoc, Jeff Beck, some of you know him, who was an applied mathematician, so he had a similar background to mine, but his intuition for these kinds of computational neuroscience problems was much better than mine. So he saw things much more easily, and he would have ideas much more easily, and the way our conversations went, that it was that Jeff would present some idea on the board, and Alex and I would sit there and say, "Oh, Jeff, that can't be true, it's too complicated, forget about it." And then 5 months later, when we had all worked on it, he said, "Yes, Jeff, you were right all along." that gave us some nice publications because of Jeff's good ideas, but also it made me feel quite inferior sometimes, because like all the good ideas were coming from him, and I was sort of the executor, the implementer. Now, that's something that over time I came to realize was a bit too one-dimensional. So, math ability is one thing that matters, but it's by no means the only thing that matters. And like we all grow up in a system where grades matter. So at some point you start thinking that ability gets measured along this one-dimensional axis, and you forget that it's actually very high dimensional, and you don't have to be good on every axis. And I might have not had the same math intuition as Jeff had, but I was better at explaining what we did to audiences who didn't know as much. Whereas Jeff would have a tendency to talk to people who knew the same amount as he did. As it turns out, when you give a job talk, it's really important to talk to people who don't know the same math as you do. So. I think that served me well later on. And yeah, I realized also that you can be very successful even though you have some really obvious weaknesses. I think there is tolerance to that. You don't have to be a perfect scientist in order to be successful in science. Imposter complex, of course, most of you have been in the series, you've heard about it. Who has those feelings very strongly? Imposter complex. Everybody knows who it is. Who doesn't know what it is, what I'm talking about? Right. In the academia, it seems to be very prominent. It's from what I read, it's if you are in a high performing job, even if it's something completely different, like in business or arts or something else, you lots of high performers have imposter complex, but in academia, it's particularly prominent, and it's gender balanced, so it's equal numbers of men and women who suffer from it. Over the course of doing these kinds of growing up in science events, I've heard lots of tricks to deal with it. So one is just to talk to each other about it. That's sort of the most obvious thing. Another thing is to to keep track of what you've learned out there. So once a year, make a list of the things that you've learned, the skills that you've developed, and it's a pretty long list. And another is to mentor somebody who's more junior than you. So if you're a postdoc, mentor a grad student. If you're a senior grad student, mentor a junior grad student. If you're a junior grad student, find yourself an undergraduate. If you're an undergraduate, find yourself a high school student. You realize how much you actually know. My favorite way of dealing with the postdoc complex is goes back to my childhood days, which is to find mistakes in other people's work. That sounds awful, but the nice part of that is that if you realize that even very successful scientists make mistakes or don't know stuff, then that makes you much feel much better about your own shortcomings. If you realize that that science is fucking hard, and that's why you make mistakes. And of course, so we are sort of used to doing that in journal papers. If you break apart a paper, also do it in talks, like ask simple questions to speakers. Either they haven't explained it correctly, or they might be like glossing over something that's actually much more complicated. Or they frankly admit that they don't know shit, which is good. Like my lab model, thanks to some students in my lab, is homines tercus nescio, which is Latin for people don't know shit. This would be like a guiding motto of all of science. But yeah, so if you realize those things, then imposter complex might be a little easier to deal with. Then I had to apply for faculty jobs. This was this is hard now. It was also hard then. It was a little bit easier then. So especially with my kind of record, where I had pretty little to show for my PhD, for my first postdoc, and I had a few good papers for my second postdoc. So first year I interviewed in 2007, I had 7 interviews and 0 offers. Second year I interviewed, I had 2 interviews and 2 offers. So I don't know if I did something better second year, or it helped that some papers had to come out in the meantime, but it's also a lottery. So now that I've been on the other side, I know that it really matters to what extent the candidate is sort of a fit to the current needs of the department. And you often have very little say in that. You study what you study, even if you do it very well, you might not be the perfect match with the current needs of a particular department where you're interviewing. Or like every department has a certain culture. It's very hard to pinpoint, but you also sort of have to fit in there. I had the lucky circumstance that I had somebody advocating for me. So at Baylor College of Medicine, it was Reed Montague, who was also a computational neuroscientist in this medical school neuroscience department. And I think he just felt lonely. He wanted another computational neuroscientist to do properly there. I think he also knew Alex Bouget, my second advisor. So that probably that probably also helped. And then, so he advocated for me, so I got that position. Of course, that was a bit of luck to me. And the first conversation I had with my chair after I got hired was my chair said, "Welcome to Baylor. There are 2 kinds of hires. There are people we hire for their accomplishments and people we hire for their promise. You clearly fall in the second category." And I don't know if that was an insult or a compliment or both at the same time, but it was very true. And I was just, I think at several points in my career, looking back, I was about to not make it, but then I had just enough people who saw more promise than, who saw beyond the lack of accomplishment and looked at the problems. Being faculty comes with its own set of insecurities. So one was, I had no idea how to hire people. So I talked about the match between mentor and mentee, and that goes both ways. So I had a tendency to focus on CV when hiring people. Bad idea. Like some people who had a great CV or had a really strong math background didn't work out in my lab because it didn't match with the spirit of my lab. For example, I had this one person who really liked working by himself all the time remotely, right? So that was his working style, and that just didn't match well with how I like to run my lab. I like to have people around, spontaneous interactions, not have to bury off having a phone call or Skype conversation to ask somebody about something. So yeah, that didn't work out very well. So yeah, that I came to realize that doing science is very much a social enterprise. And you have to much more important than how many nature papers your advisor has is whether you fit in the style of the mentorship style of your advisor and the atmosphere in the lab field. The other thing that I found difficult is to come up with my own ideas. So that sounds strange, but maybe you recognize this, that as a student, as a PhD student, as a postdoc, I always felt that other people gave me ideas. My advisor gave me ideas. My collaborators gave me ideas. And I never really had my own ideas. So I suddenly was in this position where I had to be innovative and come up with my own groundbreaking ideas, and that was very intimidating. Now that actually has a solution. The solution is pretty obvious. You just start with what you know and have a minor extension of what you know, and while you're working on that, you come up with better ideas. And that's how things worked out for me. I was faculty at Baylor for 5 years, and then I started here. So there are two reasons for that. So one is scientifically, NYU was just a much better match for me than Baylor College of Medicine. My department there was great, but the focus was more on molecular, cellular, and translational work, relatively little computation, and no the undergraduate departments like math and computer science departments was mostly like biomedical. And so scientifically things worked out better. The other reason was that I had two body problems. Anybody here in a long distance relationship? Okay, so you probably know what I'm talking about there, but my wife and I have been together since 2006. So it's 11 years, out of this 11 years, we've been apart for 9 years. And that's because we pretty much chose our what was best for our individual careers. She was in medical school in New York, but I was in Rochester. I moved to Houston. She was with me in Houston for 1 year. Then she moved to Philadelphia to continue her training there as resident fellow. I was still in Houston, then I moved to New York. We did New York, Philadelphia, the Amtrak law for 2 years. And then last year, a year and a half ago, she moved in with me here. So that's 2 out of 11 years. It sucks, right? You learn to get used to it. Of course, you don't. The Skype now. You don't have to do anything by carrier pigeon. Or of course, you start seeing the positive sides. You have more time to work. You don't have to clean up your dirty socks and leave the dirty dishes in the sink. But yeah, in the end, it still sucks. I don't know if I would have done the same thing in retrospect. It's a very personal decision. Different people have different. Balances there, but it's something that needs to be talked about. It's so common in science. So actually being hired at NYU was a big help me get rid of my imposter complex, because I felt that people here don't take bullshit, so they would have really revealed me as an imposter if I had really been. So the fact that that didn't happen was a confidence booster. The imposter complex is pretty much under control right now. The thing that is not under control is procrastination. As you know, that still persists. I still play online chess when my students are not looking. I still get involved in organizations. Some of you know. I read the news. It's addictive, way too much. If the country is falling apart, even that is addictive to read about that. The good news, I guess, that's the bad news. The good news is that you can still become a professor while being such a big professor. That pretty much brings me to the present. So I want to hear what can you relate to. Do you have any questions for me? Anything, any tips?
So you haven't remarked on the benefits of procrastination.
Benefits of procrastination?
As a faculty member.
Oh. What do you mean?
I am not a procrastinator of small projects. So somebody sends me a review, I read it on the subway because I have a subway commute, reviews done in a day or two. The student or faculty member gives me a character to read, they usually get comments in a day or two, which means people really like to give me stuff to do. It's really not a good strategy.
Right. Yeah, so Mike, for those of you who don't know, Mike is superhuman. He actually responds in time to stuff. If he promises to give you feedback, he actually does it, unlike most people. So, I don't think he is I think he's in a league of his own.
No, but you left out the implication, which is the long stuff never gets done. So if I'm the one who's supposed to write the paper, you can wait 10 years.
Well, maybe you have a different problem, which is there to say no.
that's what I'm saying. This is a benefit to procrastination in our field.
Yeah.
And most people, take advantage of it. I just happen not to be one of them.
I just wanted to add, because some people say that procrastination protects from error. That's like just adding to like all the potential positive effects of procrastination. And also, some of your procrastinatory activity became material, like games and games projects. Just in terms of how to, like in terms of spinning something that people say is negative into something positive. And I think that like this is a quality that like it's worth developing.
Yeah, it's true. Like, so one way that procrastination has been beneficial is sometimes I wait so long to revise a paper or a proposal that I can look at it with fresh eyes. Perspective of it. And what you're mentioning, like my interest in games has given us this sort of cognitive planning direction in lab. But I think I could have developed that direction even without actually personally playing 10,000 hours. Now I think what I've also heard is don't make it be too hard on yourself. Right? Like don't allow yourself some slack now and then, just relax sometimes. It doesn't work like that for me. Like I reward myself too much for too little. And I say, I've finally written this recommendation letter, let's play one game, and then one game turns into two games, and two games turns into 1 hour, and 1 hour turns into 5 a.m., and then I have to get up at 9 a.m. to make the next meet. So that's sometimes how it goes. I've tried everything, right? I've tried set myself schedules. I have tried to have my wife set a schedule for me. I have tried blocking websites and browsers. There's a thing that's called leech block, and then you have to, that work well for a while because you have to enter a random string of digits in order to unblock a website. That works until you switch browsers. One thing that I tried most recently is that my wife has blocked certain websites in a way unknown to me, so I haven't figured where I'm going. So far, that's working perfect. Let's see how long that takes. I heard of Pomodoro, and I have not tried that, but then I heard that doesn't work for other people. So,
it works better in groups.
Work better in groups, yeah. So the one thing that does work for me is sort of social pressure. So procrastination gets better if I am a collaborative project, and we have regular meetings, and I'm responsible for my part of the project, because then guilt and procrastination, they are sort of equal drivers, right? Like, and sometimes, just sometimes, if I feel that I'm responsible for my students or my postdoc's career, then that sort of pushes me to revise their paper. I think I do like talking. So one of my favorite parts of my job is to talk about people's projects. So I schedule lots of meetings in part so that I can feel productive and overcome my procrastination, even though apart from those meetings, I might not do shit.
So I want to ask if, so you said you're still a big procrastinator. My question is, do you secretly feel proud about that? In the following sense, right? Look, I procrastinate so much, but I have a wonderful life, a colorful life. I did all this NGO stuff, and I still get a 5-year position at NYU, regardless of all this stuff, and I still accomplished. And so maybe secretly, so you know procrastination is a bad thing, and you like to talk about it, but secretly you feel like, that makes me cool, because, I mean, it's like how people...
Could you be my therapist, right? So I think that might be a factor in why I like talking about it.
Yeah.
I don't know if it is, but it might be. I don't think it's a factor in procrastination itself, because I think I could have accomplished the same things and better if I hadn't spent those 10,000 hours playing online chess. And the thing that I really regret is that by the end of my life, I say, what percentage of your life have you played online games? And if it's like an actual non-negligible percentage, I feel, fuck, I really wasted my time. And now, of course, you might say it's somehow causal to me doing other things. I don't know. I don't see the link. Like, I usually just feel horrible about it. If I go back at 5, go to bed at 5 a.m. and get up at 9.
I mean, the reason I'm asking is, for example, like when some undergraduate college people take pride in not working hard, right? They don't want to be known to work hard. They want to give people the impression that they did some many other stuff and still can achieve what they achieve. And also, I guess, so for example, I play games myself, but I would, so if, after playing games, I would hate it so much that I delete the game.
Yeah.
And not just the games, but also the record.
Yeah.
So, for example, if you hate playing chess so much, you can delete your account.
Right? Oh, I created this username and I create 01. And then you need it, and then next time I create 02, and then I go up to 30. Actually, don't worry about it. I do think that it's not that I am proud that sort of I have the ability to overcome procrastination and still be successful, because I actually was about to fail at many points, and as I emphasizing, I was dependent on luck to get me through, or people were advocating for me. This is not a good strategy. It's not something I wish I had done. It's not something I would recommend to anybody. Objectively speaking, I shouldn't have been here. I should have dropped out and done something else much earlier at several points. Yeah.
So you're beating up on yourself too much, but I think you know that. You know, I'm also obsessive compulsive, and I can also fill huge amounts of time doing projects that aren't what's important in my role as a faculty member. But if there's things that you love, like playing chess, to me, there's things that, a lot of things that I love, you probably know this about me, you know, there's sports things that I like to do, a bunch of different ones, there's a lot of musical things that I do, they're a part of me. And there's nothing wrong that I have a bunch of other things that I balance with what I do here. I do all of them. I don't let any of them die. I don't do 10 hours of them very often. So that part is hard, but that doesn't mean you should shut them down.
To some extent, because at some point it crosses the line to addiction.
Yeah,
that's not good. And you know how web surfing goes, right? It's sure, reading about world events is fine, but then by clicking through lots of links, you end up reading about this bear who manages to walk on his hind legs. So, in New Jersey, it's great.
So, some of your weird questions. So, I struggle with procrastination quite often,
right.
And I always like occupy myself with mentoring people or teaching, and just find any opportunity I can to teach because I like doing that a lot.
Yeah.
But the question I always ask myself is am I procrastinating? And am I doing not doing work because I don't like it? You know what I mean? I still don't really answer the question. I find things interesting, and I really want to study it, but then why do I not spend the time doing it?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Now, I have this weird thing where something is actually a really minor task, but like writing a recommendation letter or filling out some grant report or so. It's really minor task, but it's sitting on my to-do list for so long that it takes on these gigantic proportion. It becomes, in my mind, this giant hurdle that I can never overcome, that's the bane of my existence. And then I just go into escapist behavior right away. And I see this one, and I say, oh no. It's going to destroy me. And then I play just one game of chess. Jerry?
I was just going to say, I think, to some degree, like, you're, one, I think as Redskins, we're building our kind of experience doing lots of things, and to another degree, I think I always feel self-conscious about this, but I remember it was Kathy Nagle and David Chopek's version of this, where Kathy said something about having, like, two to four good hours per day, and if she could get the most out of those, if she can recognize when those occur, and it's usually the same time, but sometimes you get one in the afternoon. And sometimes if you have a deadline, you can really, like, bring it out, but, you know, it comes from somewhere. And I feel like I've tried to be at least more strategic about, like, procrastinating, like, finding time to procrastinate when my brain doesn't, like, when my brain is active doing work, and when my brain is, like, dripping out of my ears reading the New York Times. And then it tends to drip faster these days. But,
Yeah, sorry, many people, I don't know who's
first. I had a question about the imposter syndrome. So you told multiple ways to deal with it yourself. And I was wondering, do you do anything or would you recommend anything if you see it happen in your students or your postdocs or say, or you said, maybe if you feel better about what you know if you take an undergraduate and you see this is happening in undergraduate,
yeah.
Would you, or do you do anything explicitly or?
Yeah, so I think I have smaller versions of this conversation with people in my lab. I also try to praise effort, not results. That doesn't always work. As scientists, we're triggered to praise results, but effort, even my field, is really important. And I also try to recognize, to mention as often as possible that a problem is actually hard, and if you get to it only part way, it's not your failure. And I talk about my own failures quite a bit. Maybe it's the point that my students have no respect for me. But I actually think it's healthy to have the kind of environment where respect doesn't depend on failure. Right? Effort, I still, is a big deal. But yeah, we're humans and we're trying. It's already hard enough if you don't make it hard for each other. Maria.
First of all, Rochester's beautiful, everyone. I don't appreciate this move, but that's okay. No difference. So I have a question about the transition between postdoc to deciding to pursue faculty position, because it seems you had this common theme. You're a very social person. You have lots of hobbies. And you could have had, you know, alternate lives. Who knows? Maybe there are other wages doing other things. So I guess, at what point did you decide this is what I want to commit to? Did you have kind of a rule if the second round doesn't work out, I'm going to move on? And was it kind of the momentum carrying you, and you said this is the natural step, or was it something you're really passionate about being PI?
Yeah, so I think it's mostly the momentum, and I'm glad you're mentioning as an option, because not often people think about that. So I was very much a happy-go-lucky kind of person, because things had worked out for me in the past. Mm-hmm. I thought things would continue to work out, and I actually didn't that seriously consider the possibility that I might not get a faculty job. So I went with the flow, and I wasn't really surprised that people eventually offered me a faculty job. That sounds awful, but that's pretty much how it was. And the other thing is that I always had so many other interests that I never considered it so bad to not continue in science. In fact, I wrote quite early on about how torn I was between continuing in science versus doing something more society useful. Because my big qualm about science has been ivory tower, you're isolating yourself from society, you know, the research is often very difficult to translate to something that's directly useful. Political involvement is often lacking, both in your science and among scientists. So none of those things I liked. So I always felt, how can I reconcile those two sides of me? And if it had somehow gone the other way, I might have been really happy. Now, the other thing is that I did realize that being a postdoc was not the best stage of a scientific career for me. So for some people, being postdoc is the perfect time of their career because they are more independent than as a student, but they don't have all the responsibilities of a faculty. For me, it wasn't that way. For me, being faculty was much better
because I was always the kind of person who wanted to have their fingers in many pots, so to be involved in many projects at the same time. Of course, that's easier in the faculty position. Also, because of this social type of structure in which I function best, you have that more as a faculty than as a postdoc. So I often did realize that if I ever would make it to faculty, that would actually be a much better position in than I had been in at any point during either grad school or postdoc. So I did look forward to that aspect of being faculty, that might have been a driver. But yeah, I think it's really interesting to think about how about the other way teaching, how they would have turned out. Yeah, it's sometimes just chance where you end up. Right? People who end up choosing very different paths, they could have been faculty as well. Agenda thing.
Do you think that you're a good mentor, and why?
Do I think I'm a good mentor, and why? I think I'm generally a good mentor because I could get good feedback on mentorship. But I also get some criticism sometimes, and I try to learn from that, but it's hard. So one point of criticism that I got when I was beta is that this was a research assistant who said, every time we meet, I present my results to you, and you pretty much the next thing you say is, what's the next thing we can do? I just wish you would spend a little bit more time appreciating all the work that went into these results. And that's true. We often have a tendency to just move forward, take the next step, without pausing and just paying attention to the effort that went into something. So that was a bit of a wake-up while trying to do that more often. More recently, people have complained that I'm not available enough. That's also very true. I have a lab that's a little bit too big for my taste. Like maybe 11 people now. And I'd like to bring that down to maybe 7 or 8 people. So maybe not hire immediately if somebody moves on. I think that's a way that I could be a better mentor and be more available like I used to be in the early days. Also, one thing that we try to do is twice a year we have evaluation meetings where I say frankly how the students or the postdocs work is going, and they say frankly how my job as boss is going. And I think that's useful. Doesn't mean that there's still not other things that we can do to improve mentorship. So.
So you mentioned when you have sort of mentor in Jeff Beck that was like the smart guy that was telling you everything what to do. So at what point, like now that you are more what he was at that point, I mean, you're telling a lot of people and you kind of suggested maybe telling, you know, having an undergraduate to mentor or something like that, you know, you overcome that sort of imposter syndrome like thing. When you like talk to Jeff now or see him, do you still have like, I guess what I'm wondering is, do you still think of him on that pedestal where you're still like, I'm still intimidated by what he knows? Or do you think it's just that at some point you justified yourself and you branched off in a different space than he was and you can do things that he can do?
Yeah, I think it's the latter. One other difference besides that I like better to present to general audiences was that I was also very interested in psychophysics, and he has mostly been a computational neuroscientist. The psychophysics opens up an entirely new direction, so I'm very different now from what Jeff's doing, although he starts with experience as well. But I think the most important thing is meta-realization that like success is multidimensional, and like there's plenty of space for people with very different kinds of skill sets.
So like a recurring theme in a lot of what you said is like having potential, like as a, you know, you're a child prodigy, you skipped a bunch of grades. Got your PhD really early, and then eventually got a job, not because of your confidence, but because of your promise. Was that kind of a big component of your imposter complex? And if so, at what point did you manage to like internally decide, I'm no longer someone with potential who's maybe not good at what I do, but I'm young, but considering how young I am, it's acceptable to, okay, I'm actually good at
something. Yeah, so it was a big part of the imposter complex, especially because I was in Dutch media around the time of my PhD, and I knew that it wasn't based on much substance. So that, of course, is the perfect recipe for And that kind of disconnect is a progress before imposter complex. And I that only gradually went away, in part because I started realizing that many people have imposter complex, that it has a name even. And also, just coming back also to John's question about the math, I realized that you don't have to be a math genius in order to be a successful computational neuroscientist or computational psychologist, or because like the math that we use in this field is maybe it's not rocket science, but and usually when it's as complicated as rocket science, it's probably a wrong model because it's so complicated. So with just pretty basic math, calculus in algebra, and probability theory, you get 95% of all the models in our field. And that's a level where I feel comfortable. As a former physicist, I would have felt, oh, this is just child's play, like this kind of math, and you're clearly not smart enough to do anything better in terms of math. But now I say, well, who cares? This is what does the job in this field, and I'm comfortable at this level. So I don't need to feel inferior to a physicist. That's not my comparison point. Yeah.
You said you play a lot of chess games, but only online games. Have you ever been to a chess contest, actual chess contest before? And if not, was that because of the denial that you are actually becoming or going toward the direction of being a professional game player?
Yeah, so the biggest fight that I had during my mom with my mom during my childhood was that I wanted to be a professional chess grandmaster, and she didn't allow me, and then I said maybe I can do this part-time, be a part-time grandmaster. and part of why I didn't get anything done in my first postdoc is because I went to all these chess tournaments in LA with the undergraduate chess club with Caltech, I spent a lot of time on that as well. But eventually, with somebody who has such a short attention span and needs so much instant gratification as me, like a real chess game that takes 6 hours sometimes, was just, it took too long. it's too much effort too. I didn't think that since college I decided to go professional, or considered going professional.
Because, as you know, Mike is very interested in the musical stuff, and he does get involved and is actively, like, goes to concerts and does active performance, like live performance.
Yeah.
So maybe instead of only doing online, you can restrict yourself to only do actual contests if you want to.
Yeah, so
not
there's problems
online
with that. Thanks for your suggestions for how I could procrastinate one. But I think the difficulty with online chess, like with real life chess, is that if you play for 6 hours and then you lose, it's devastating. You put so much effort in it and you have nothing to show for it.
And then you will never play it again.
No! You say, next time I'm going to do better.
Okay.
Who was next? Javier.
So, your procrastination is a fascinating part of this. And one of the questions is, how many times do you wind up going off the cliff? Or do you know, have you figured out how to take yourself right to the edge? That's what I do, right, is I've learned, what's the point of no return? Okay, shit. And there is an intoxicating, you know, rocket
fuel. I'm his wife, I can tell
you.
You
prevent him from going off the cliff.
He's right.
That you get a lot more done per unit time when you're really there. And then the other things sort of fade away. And who knows how, but there's some hard to quantify value for what was going on in the background during those other, you know, supposedly non-task focused activities. You say bring franchise to it, but I mean, there really is an aspect of, oh, you know, all of a sudden there's things, in part because of desperation. Now there's no room for error, right?
Yeah.
If the printer's broken or this or that, holy shit. But in part that feeds this and that, and then we succeed, and that's a huge driver.
Yeah.
Of, you know.
Yeah.
God.
So No, I can't steer myself away from the cave usually. So I actually had real failures because of my procrastination that, like, I screwed up how I thought about a particular topic because I wasn't well prepared. My grant proposal didn't go in on time, or I gave a lot of people a lot of trouble because I was a last minute worker. But adrenaline does definitely play a role in that. If you can get away with it, it's sometimes really bad. In terms of stuff going in the background, in my experience, the online chess doesn't really get me down there. like you're playing sports or so, right? That does help. Mm-hmm. Like distract your mind in a positive way. But yeah, I felt very little positive effect on like the my kind of procrastination. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think it's like you're known as like a pretty good like teacher and probably like pretty good mentor. Like, and then when I was like applying to be like one of your teaching assistants, you gave like very specific advice on like how to be like a better teacher. Whereas lots of people can teach and like not know what makes a good teacher. But like, and I also know like during one of these like panels of like when people asked a bunch of professors like what makes a good mentor, a lot of people just said it's the fit for most of them, and then you gave like 5 points that other like very specific. How is it that you've like picked up these deliberate specific advice, like these specific things, and like what things do you think people miss a lot?
Yeah, so I think the most important thing is just to care and to be cognizant of it, right? Because there's plenty of material out there on how to become a better mentor, but as faculty, we often don't take the time to read about it or to talk with others about it. Education is something that I've always been very interested in. My nonprofit is also education related. And it's actually ridiculous that as university professors, we don't even get formal training in teaching. And we pretty much have to figure it out by ourselves. Some do, some don't. Like in our field, we don't get formal training. Maybe in other fields, it does happen. But it's also pretty straightforward. Like very simple things like try to relate to the background of your audience. Build a sufficient number of interaction models. Have enough peer instruction or group discussion. Active learning, those kinds of things. It's really straightforward. Educational science has known this for decades. As university professors in sciences, we often don't know about this, or we don't care enough to incorporate it in our practice. So the fact that I'm an exception says less about me than how screwed up the system is. Especially, I must say, in a research university as at NYU, of course, it's great we want to be great at research, but it's sometimes at the cost of teaching that we hire faculty for their research accomplishments and research ability, but not so much for their ability to teach, and we barely ask about that, and we barely train people about it, and that's, I think, really a missed opportunity. I'll continue for 5 more minutes. Yeah.
Didn't you also go to the teaching thing, though, to learn how to teach from
the
teaching
level? Yeah, so I often try to go to these kinds of events where, so there's, for example, this Center for Advancement of Teaching, that's an NRU center that can send somebody to your class to observe and give you feedback. I did that in one of my classes. That was really useful. They get useful feedback. You can go to workshops that they organize. I co-organize a workshop like that for the psychology faculty. There's stuff that you can do. You can be more or less active in that, but just as a professor to improve your own teaching, it's actually not that hard. It's just to make a little bit better. Yeah.
I guess this goes back a few minutes, but you mentioned kind of enjoying having a hand in multiple different projects.
Yeah.
I find it paralyzing having multiple things to work on at the same time.
Yeah.
Like especially like if things get to the point where I can no longer write them in a short list.
Yeah.
It's just totally debilitating. Do you feel like that becomes? But I do like the idea of doing multiple things at once.
Yeah.
So do you feel like that's maybe easier in your position because you're kind of at a higher altitude? Okay.
That's a very simple answer. So I have. I'm still quite detail oriented, I think, but I don't do the actual work, so it's a lot easier to be involved in any projects. Now, I wouldn't overdo it the way I do it, because I have a tendency to pick up lots of collaboration to the point that I currently have 50 unfinished projects. And I can show you the list. I'm not making this up. This is not a hyperbole. It's actually 50 unfinished projects. That's a little bit insane. Like, now I can't have kids anymore because kids are being unfinished projects.
So you have to
accept the 5 kids? any more questions, comments? Yeah.
I know you're super into like outreach and advocacy.
Yeah.
Do you feel like you've accomplished a lot in that domain, or like made the public more aware of, like, I'm not sure what your nonprofit is, but like, do you feel like you've reached out and like kind of changed how people see science? Or?
Yeah. So the nonprofit is working in rural China, so to improve the quality of teaching there. Sort of going back to my ancestral roots, but that's a bit of a different focus. In terms of science outreach, I have done less than many of you, so many of you have taught in many more high schools, many more times than I have. I do what I can in that regard. I sometimes go to schools, I have been to the brain fair. I now have started this, I want to write this popular book about the link between visual illusions and how the brain computes for abilities. So, to make this more accessible to general audiences. I think that's going to be my big thing. So ask me again in 3 years or however long my procrastination is.
Do you think
Red Gate
would fall into like, the
answer
to the earlier question?
And so I'm also involved in this organization, many of you are as well, so the Scientist Advocacy and Action Network, which is trying to be more societally engaged, more politically engaged, to help nonprofits with our kinds of data science, as well as neuroscience and quality expertise. And I think that's just super important that we as scientists have that foot in society. And I would always encourage my students and my postdocs to have that. I don't think it has to be at the cost of scientific productivity. In many cases, it might make you more motivated or more balanced person overall. I do know that all the labs have different ideas about this, so don't take my view is universal on that. But I do think, my personal view is that if you're just doing science and you're forgetting that you're also a citizen and an educated citizen for that matter, then I think you're also missing a lot in terms of the impact that you could have. One more, yeah.
You usually like to end these growing up in sciences by asking the person an embarrassing question. I can't think of a very good one, so can you tell us something you find very embarrassing?
Very too open-ended, I'm going to enjoy it. You come up with something right now.
Is this
someone
a procrastination project? Is
growing up in
sciences
I
don't be a firefighter or a musician.
So I think growing up in science is a healthy mix of procrastination and actually trying to make an academic system a little bit better.
So you want to be a firefighter?
I wanted to be an actor.
So if you lost your tenure right now, would you go somewhere?
What would I do
if you lost your tenure right now?
Well, I think the most obvious thing is to try to find a faculty position somewhere else. Right?
You've committed scientific fraud and you're banned from all of
them. All right. There are lots of jobs that would probably not take me, but I would.
No one else knows.
What would. high school science teachers, something that holds appeal to me. Popular science writer, or doing a full time nonprofit work. That would be my options. Right, thanks for coming.